Craig coming? No, it's okay. Leave it there.
I just you want us to call it this. I have a really good program with Cornell and invested in it on looking at biochar and all that.
Oh, maybe
yeah,
I'll
that's
come up to you. Thanks.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's very good.
Meeting with
oh,
someone
good.
In Japan, they're like 10 minutes off.
Yeah,
that's why I don't want to sit in front of
them. Yeah, sure.
It would be good if you start up.
Okay, so we'll start. Thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Satya Tripathi. I am the moderator of your session. And we have with us four extraordinary professionals to give us some very strategic insight into why regenerative agriculture could be the solution that we are all looking for. But before that, allow me a few minutes to frame the conversation. So the way I see it, there are three things that are extremely important in the context. The first being that we have a lot of solutions being thrown around, that this could solve the problem, that could solve the problem. What we have seen in the last 27 versions of the COP, that there has been very little meaningful conversation around regenerative agriculture or sustainable agriculture. It is the first time that at a COP, you have four food systems pavilions for the first time. So it is finally getting into the minds and the thought processes of key member nations, of course, but stakeholders as well. The second thing is that while renewable energy and of course, different forms of mitigation, catalytic technologies have been put forward as possible solutions. They certainly are, but they don't heal much. They prevent emissions or they stabilize emissions at a certain point and reduce emissions by better technologies. With regenerative agriculture, you can get both. You can reduce emissions by, you know, preventing water use intensity. And in many parts of the developing world where people pump water out of the ground, so by extension, you use less water, you use less electricity. And much of the electricity in many parts of the world that's agricultural use electricity is fossil fuel based because mostly people use diesel generating sets to be able to pump water from under the ground. So you get reduction credits and you get sequestration credits as well. And the third is, I think the most important, is that from a technology perspective, we are now talking about direct air capture, getting carbon out of the air and turning it into stone and putting it back in the ground. Fantastic. But it costs $650 a ton for removal. Whereas if we were just going to pay $50 or $100 to the farmer, they would actually not only remove it, but put it back in a way that heals our ecosystems, brings back biodiversity like never seen before, and actually solves most of the problems, both on adaptation and mitigation. That's why we're talking about regenerative agriculture today. So the way we'll go about today is that we have four extraordinary panelists. I don't want to introduce them because you know them already, but I'll request them to introduce them in a minute and then take the next 5 minutes to talk a little bit about how regenerative agriculture has scaled up recently across the planet. And each one of them will bring a very different perspective Dr. Ravi Prabhu is currently, he leads one of the most consequential research institutions in the world to agroforestry and also regenerative agriculture. Professor Steiger, again, you know, she started her career in ICRAF, and now she leads a very consequential, again, think tank out of Cornell. The Honorable Minister heads natural resources conversation in one of the largest countries in the Caribbean, Guyana. And Eric Solheim, of course, former head of UNEP, former head of OECD DAC, and then many other things. I think the one thing that I find the best thing to mention to his credit is that during the time he was Minister for International Development in Norway and Environment in Norway, ODA reached the highest levels. And thank you for leading that, because that's a benchmark to follow for the rest of the developed world. So let me stop there and start with, we'll just go sequentially, start with Ravi. So please introduce yourself in a minute and 5 to 7 minutes to frame the conversation so that we have enough time for Q&A. Thank you, Ravi.
Thank you, Satya. Well, I'm not going to spend too much time on myself. I'm really pleased to be here in the EECA Pavilion and talking about sustainable agriculture. So I'd like to make a couple of points here just to start the conversation rolling. We're almost turning a full circle in the sense of going back to the ecological roots of agriculture in many landscapes. But we're doing that with the benefit now of 100 years of science. And in the last several decades, the benefit of agroecological science to understand where science can help us to harvest, productively harvest the diversity of useful plant and animal species. What has happened in conventional agriculture has been a narrowing of species. So you've got 98% of all research funds going to roughly about 10 commodities. So there's just a limit to how much nutrition you can get from a kilo of rice or a bowl of maize. It just isn't possible to breed everything into that. On the other hand, we have a huge number of useful species which are both nutritious. And if you include the tree species that we work on, you can get multiple benefits in these landscapes. We have shown productivity increases using nitrogen-fixing species to triple maize or corn production. So what we need to do is to understand that regenerative agriculture or agroecology offers an opportunity to inject science, technology, traditional farmer wisdom, and the incredible treasure trove of nature into our food systems in a way, as Satya has pointed out, that restores soils by adding soil organic carbon, bringing nitrogen from the atmosphere and fixing it in soils, managing water. The trees are the most effective hydrological pumps we've got. In the Sahel, crops go far better under trees than they do in the open. So there's a lot of research to suggest this. Our challenge is to create a value chain around knowledge-intensive systems rather than technology-intensive systems. And I can come back to that later. I think we have a tremendous opportunity. And I would like to identify and agree with the millions of farmers who are shifting their production systems. We work with farmers in India, there's over 1.5 million of them, as well as farmers across Africa and Latin America who are shifting their production systems successfully for their livelihoods, moving up value chains in their production by moving to regenerative agriculture techniques, including trees and crops and livestock in integrated systems. So with that, I'll hand over to Erica.
Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me. And hello, everyone. I'm Erica Steiger. I'm a professor of practice at Cornell University. I'm a tropical agronomist. Actually, I started my career at ICRAF. So I'm an agroforester at heart. But then I worked in many different agriculture systems around Africa, mostly. Always working on ecological approaches. I worked since 15 years on rice, on the system of rice intensification, which I want to talk a little bit about as a case study. As for regenerative agriculture, we could talk about agroecology, sustainable agriculture, climate smart agriculture. What the key essence is, though, is the how do we create synergies within ecological processes, no? And how can we build on those synergies? So regenerate agriculture, I really love the term, or we could even say regenerate and more, or regenerate and generate, because we can create systems that are even more productive than the natural systems, but we can build on all the natural processes. They work for us, no? So how can we be smart to have nature work for us? And there's some simple entry points like soils. No, I mean, we need to start with soils, with vegetation, agroforestry, integrating all the, looking at the landscape aspect of it, looking how water flows through the landscape. I mean, there's some really interesting key entry points that are simple and we can build on those. So then we get all these diversified systems, no? They are very location specific. Now the question is, all right, scaling. How do we scale? Because these systems are site specific, very knowledge intense, no? Very management intense, and each location is different. And so so the question of scaling is then kind of a challenge. And I started to work on rice 15 years ago. Now rice is basically a crop that people think they know how to grow it. You know, you put it in water. Of course, rice wants water. No, rice doesn't want much water. And so then people think, well, people have done this for 1,000 years or thousands of years. Why would we now like take water away and plant rice differently? But the question is, the method, actually, the SRI or system of rice intensification was developed in Madagascar empirically by a group of farmers with a Jesuit priest to just synthesized observations. And from there, it started to spread throughout the world. People try to bring those methods to their own systems, and so they adapted it. Now, as I mentioned, rice is usually grown in water, densely planted. The root systems will be very shallow. No? The plants are actually very weak. And if you look at the potential of a rice plant, it doesn't thrive in those systems. You can, a rice plant is actually a very plastic plant. If you put it in a good environment, it really starts to explode on you. And so the question becomes more, how do we actually do agriculture from the crop perspective? And I think we need to revisit agronomy, revisit how we do plantings, because we haven't really figured that one out. Because right now it's like more is more. We need more water, more chemicals, more seed, and we will produce more. And the plants get weaker and more diseased and more resources. So so that is basically the shift, the paradigm shift with the SRI system. We plant less seed, 90% less seed, wider spaced, young plants, less water, less chemical, and the plant starts to produce double production, sometimes 20%, 50%, depends, sometimes 100% more production. So then we put farmers and everybody says, hey, what's going on? I mean, is there something we're missing here? So, and I think that is the interesting part about, it's ultimately like an entry point for when I started working on it in Mali 15 years ago, the farmers told me, hey, what's this? We want to work on this. You stay with us and we're going to figure this out together. And I felt, well, you know, I've never seen that actually you can get those win-win situations. So I stayed with it and I don't regret it. So right now I'm working at the global level. When we're thinking about, again, do I have still 2 minutes? Yeah. If we're thinking about, I mentioned about scaling up. Now, people, well, so at one point, SRI started to travel the world and people started to do different things. Oh, I plant, I direct seed, I add manure, I use cover crop. So then people, there was a lot of pushback. People started to ask, so what is this SRI? Can you tell me the method, you know, the techniques? And there was a lot of confusion and there was a controversy that were like, this is too good to be true. This is anecdotal. It doesn't really work. It works here like this, work this like that, but it doesn't really make, we don't really understand. But I think that was more like the pushback for people who maybe were a little jealous that there was something that actually could work for the farmers. And so we tried then to think about the guiding principles, no? What are some of the guiding cropping principles, like early establishment, reduce competition between plants, so each plant has the space to regenerate your soils, only water as needed. And with these four principles, everybody could now go into their location and start working, you know? How do I adapt those principles, regenerate? So how do I do that right on my farm? And it looks different from the desert region to the rainforest region. So then we can bring people back and identify those best practices, no? According to climate zone, according to rice systems. So it becomes this circular learning approach, no? So we work on principles, people adapt, go deep, you know, we need to go really deep with regenerative agriculture. We need to really understand and go deeper and deeper and deeper in our understanding because we have to learn still a lot. But I think by that, if we can bring that back, synthesize, learn, we can kind of create a community of practice according to agriculture, you know, like land use systems, climate zones, etc. And so that's a little bit, I'm working on a project in West Africa. We work with 13 countries where we're scaling up SRI. And we're working according to that method because we have the desert region in Mali down to the rainforest region in Liberia. We have really different environments. So that's basically the way we want to develop the best practices and then build on those. It's an entry point. So maybe I stop. No, I could yes.
Good morning. My name is Vikram Bharat, Minister of Natural Resources, Guyana, South America. I just want to emphasize on that because a lot of people have been mixing up with Guyana with Ghana. Actually, we had some of our meals that went to Ghana instead. And some of the Ghanaians' meal went to Guyana instead. So we are part of the Caribbean community, even though we are not located geographically in the West Indies in the Caribbean, because we are the only English-speaking country in South America and within very close proximity to the Caribbean. We have signed on to the Treaty of Chagaramas, being part of the Caribbean community, CARICOM. So we are more linked to Trinidad, Barbados, Jamaica, Bahamas, more than we are linked to our countries or our friends in South America. Let me thank you for the invite and having me on the program. But I would like to take the conversation or make it a little different before I actually go into the meat of the matter. I know the time is limited. It is so difficult for us to divorce climate change and food security. It is almost impossible to do that. Many years ago, when we started speaking about climate change and the effects of climate change, I think only Norway listened to us. And we had a very good partnership with Norway, an excellent bilateral agreement where Guyana benefited from over 200 million Guyana dollars for its forests. And for those of you who are not aware, our forest is probably the size of the United Kingdom. 86% of Guyana's forests, 90% almost virgin forests, capacity to hold 19.5 billion tons of carbon. So that is the kind of forest that we're speaking of in Guyana. So it, like I said, it's almost impossible to divorce the conversation of climate change from food security. And when we spoke of climate change many years ago, there were many who were adamant and very hesitant to buy into the whole concept that there will be severe impacts and effects of climate change. And we need to have mitigating measures put in place as early as possible. And today we have reached a stage where we're talking about adaptation and financing for that adaptation. Today, the world is speaking a lot more about food security. And there are many among us who are still a little taken back and say, no, we have enough food. But I'm sure, and I'm almost positive, that in another 5 years from now, the conversation will become even more real, that food security will be one of the biggest problems that we are faced with in this world, merely because of climate change and what is happening around the world. In our country, we lost hundreds of thousands of acres of rice in 2021 because of flooding. Presently, part of our country is underwater, where there's large coconut plantation, and we're trying to cultivate coffee and cocoa in that area now. It's underwater. So we cannot divorce the reality that we need to address the issues of climate change. And, you know, coming to COP and having all these conversations, having the world leaders, having the technicians and all of us gathered here, it's good. Coming to this workshop, this plenary, and have this conversation, it's good. But I think by now we all know what the problem is. So it will be very unproductive for us to keep regurgitating what the problems are. I think we need to move to the stage of solution, and that is why I welcome the comments that were made here this morning, because it's about finding solution to move forward. It's about finding solution to address the issue of climate change and more so food security. But I think there's also another problem that we need to address too. How do we get countries and people and communities to go back into agriculture? That is a problem I think that we should address too, because many countries, many communities, even our indigenous communities in Guyana have moved away from agriculture, and agriculture is not seen as lucrative and as something that will attract young people towards it. So it's more of a big issue to get people to go back to agriculture in our part of the world, especially the Caribbean, and to make agriculture a bit more attractive and lucrative to the younger population, because we have almost 30 to 40% of our population is below the age of 30. And if you tell them to go into agriculture, they would say, no, I prefer ICT. I prefer some other field, but not agriculture. We have with us here from the Guyana delegation, the head of our indigenous peoples in Guyana, Mr. Derek John, who is the head of our indigenous peoples in Guyana, representing 10% of our population. And he would tell you, it's the devil's job to get the young people, even in the indigenous community, to go into agroforestry, because it's forested area. And that has been practiced over centuries. So we've been working as a government to get our indigenous brothers and sisters to go back into agroforestry, which is critical, which is important. Our president is actually leading the food security charge in CARICOM, where there's a pledge of 25 by 2025, simply meaning that we are aiming to cut our food importation bill by 25% by the year 2025. It's ambitious in the context of what is happening in the Caribbean right now, but we believe if we work towards it, incorporating new technologies, new species, new varieties, as we've been doing, And in Guyana, we have the same problem with the rice cultivation, where farmers sometimes tend to push or to cultivate three crops in a year as against two, which is the prescribed amount, or which is good for the soil. However, they push for three. We have been working with them to have better variety, so the yield becomes higher, it's more profitable. These are all issues that we're trying to address in Guyana, because we believe as a country that has a vast amount of open land, we don't have to experience deforestation to venture into wide-scale, large-scale agriculture, that we can become the true breadbasket of the Americas, not the Caribbean, but the Americas. We sit in a good position to do so. But with regards to regenerative agriculture, this is something new to us, I must admit. We are now getting into that. We are now starting to different tillage, meaning different preparation of our land. It's so hard to get farmers to change. In fact, nobody wants to accept changes, but changes, as we know, is inevitable. It must happen. If you want higher yield, if you got to become mechanized, automated, it means that you have to accept changes, do things differently. And to get our farmers to accept those changes, that the land must be prepared differently now, as opposed to how we used to do it 20 years ago or 30 years ago. They would say, you know what? I've been doing this since you were born, or since before you were born. So now you're coming to tell me that I should do it differently. So it's the whole buy-in by our farmers and on the scale at which we do it too, because we are not mega farms, we are not large scale as yet in the Caribbean, but we are getting there. So we have started with different land preparation. As a first step, we would have taken agroforestry, as I mentioned, and of course, with the integration of crops and the rotation of crops, we're trying to move away from just rice and sugarcane, which we are known for, which is the history why we are in the West Indies. And we are trying to move away to different crops, to other crops. So that is some of the programs that is being rolled out presently in Guyana. It is also happening in our sister countries, Suriname, Barbados, and a few other countries in CARICOM that is participating in agriculture. But as I mentioned, we have another problem, that is to get people to go back to the fields and to start cultivating so that we have food security. Thank you.
First of all, I would like to start with thanking you and thanking Sabta, because this is exactly the conversations we need. I mean, there is hardly any area where there is such a difference between the importance of the topic and the amount of attention to the topic as when it comes to green agriculture. I mean, agriculture is one of the main sources of carbon emission. And as we heard here, of course, agriculture is absolutely key for global food security. Still, it tends to be very low on the global agenda. There are very few conferences and very rare that top political leaders really focus on agriculture. And of course, that also leads to the fact that most young people in the world desperately want to get into anything else but agriculture, as you so well said from Guyana. So it's so important with this conversation. I'm no expert on rice or any other agriculture field, so I will take the kind of political perspective. Let me start by highlighting two success stories, because obviously what we want is more production. We need more agriculture productivity, and at the same time, it needs to be done in a greener fashion than today. In the Indian state of Andhra Pradesh, I think they have the biggest, not small scale pilot program, but large scale program of bringing a huge amount of farmers into what's called zero budget natural farming, which is green agriculture. And it gets higher yields, much better health for the farmers, and of course, it's much better and kinder to Mother Earth, all at the same. Close to 1 million farmers are now into this scheme. Well, that's 6 million people, if you include the families. In the Indian, with the scale of India, some people say, well, this is a pilot program. Well, the people included are more than the entire population of my nation, Norway, and we hardly see Norway as a pilot. So this is big. And what they've done, I mean, Sri Lanka tried to do some of the same, but they got it completely wrong. Because in Andhra Pradesh, this is about speaking to the farmers, having a dialogue, make sure that you are, if you are very successful, others will come to you and learn from you and ask, what did you do? Can I do some of the same? It takes time, but it works. What Sri Lanka unfortunately tried to do was to cut off fertilizer in one day. With no warning to the farmers, no training programs for something else, no dialogue between farmers, no nothing. And of course, it was an absolutely catastrophe. And one of the reasons for the economic problem Sri Lanka is currently into. Andhra Pradesh is a shining example of increasing agriculture productivity is Vietnam. I believe Vietnam is probably the most successful nation in the world when it comes to overall agriculture. First time I came to Vietnam, it was absolutely poor, enormous poverty, and it was the biggest rice importer in the world. Now Vietnam is the second biggest rice exporter in the world, while at the same time increasing the living standard of the Vietnamese. They are, by the way, also now, I think, the second biggest exporter of coffee in the world, next to Brazil. I mean, what a fantastic success. Vietnam has no history with coffee. No one was drinking coffee in Vietnam in the past. They just got it right. And what did they get right? No rocket science, nothing expensive. Just number one, they made sure that the farmers had the property rights to the farm. Otherwise, you will not invest. They made sure that farmers had small loans to invest. They made sure there were rural roads so that farmers could get the products to the market. And there were training programs to bring the best scientific knowledge to the farmers. None of this is very costly. None of this is rocket science. It just works. So I think Vietnam and Andhra Pradesh in India are shining examples of what the world at large should look to. Then, of course, agriculture, as the minister from Guyana so eloquently spoke to, is not in isolation. It must be seen also linked to the greening of landscapes, to conservation of forest, and to tree planting. And here I'm very optimistic, I have to say. We started in Norway working with Guyana, with Brazil, and with Indonesia, what's called UN RED, or the program to support rainforest in the world. Last year, Indonesia came to zero. There was no deforestation in the second biggest rainforest nation in the world, which is Indonesia. Why was that? Well, not at all thanks to Norway, but thanks to good policies from the Indonesian government. The Jokowi government has got all the right legislation through the parliament. And secondly, the efforts of the big business in Indonesia. Just to mention one company, which is called RGE, Royal Golden Eagle. It's the biggest paper and pulp company in the world, one of the biggest palm oil companies in the world. So it's a massive company. They have made sure that there is no deforestation in their value chains, and that they are now even one of the biggest forces conserving the rainforest in Indonesia, because they have the helicopters and the fire brigades and a lot of the equipment, which unfortunately the Indonesian government at this level lacks. So Indonesia is successful, and I'm absolutely confident that with the election of Lula in Brazil, we will see the same in Brazil. Last time Lula was the president, he reduced deforestation with 80%, because he empowered indigenous peoples out in the forest, he gave them power, and he mobilized the forces of a modern state, Brazil, police, army, the state apparatus, to protect rather than to destroy the forest. For sure, he will face difficulties, no doubt. But I'm confident that he will succeed in these. And Guyana, of course, is one of the prime examples of this. Yes, true, Brazil and Indonesia are much bigger. But Guyana is maybe the most eclatant global example of a nation which has kept the rainforest basically intact, and they should be rewarded for that. Let me at the end also say we should not just conserve the forests which are already there. We should increase the forest cover in the world. And by far, the biggest contributor to that is China. China is now in a league by itself when it comes to tree planting and greening of landscapes. President Xi just promised that China will plant an area the size of Belgium every year from now to 2030. Well, Belgium is not a big area, but still it really matters. And the way the Chinese are approaching this is fantastic. We'll just end up with a couple of Indian examples. The chief minister of the Indian state of Madhya Pradesh, he's planting one tree every day. Well, that's of course creating a small forest just by Mr. Chauhan. But more importantly, he's inspiring 80 million people in the state of Madhya Pradesh to do the same. 80 million people, that's the population of Germany. It matters if all of them start in planting trees. And in the state of Tamil Nadu, where I was just elected him to the Climate Council, also 80 million people, also the size of Germany. They have now promised that they will increase the tree cover in Tamil Nadu from 23 to 33% in one decade. That will be a huge challenge. But when the chief minister, Mr. Stalin, makes this promise, of course it matters, and they will put the forces of the state behind this. And maybe they will not be 100% successful, but still it matters a lot. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Eric, and thank you, Minister. Thank you, Eric, and thank you, Ravi, for those very insightful comments. We have roughly about 20 minutes. We'll do a little bit of a Q&A so that the audience can also ask questions. But before that, I just wanted to bring it all together for the audience. So there's hope. Although young people would like to be all employed in ICT or other sectors, if you look at, let's take the case of the steel industry or the automotive industry or the IT and the IT-enabled services industry and all their ancillaries. Everything put together, 35 million jobs globally. That's the industry number. Agriculture employs 1 billion people. So that's how big it is. Whether we accept it or not, those are the numbers. There are 500 million smallholders on the planet. And they are the best entrepreneurs one can think of, because the risk they manage every crop cycle is absolutely important, because that's what keeps their families going. The children fed, sent to school, healthcare, nutrition, everything you can think of comes from one crop cycle to the next. That's what smallholders do. So to me, they are the bravest entrepreneurs on the planet. With regenerative agriculture, there's hope for them. Because what we have seen in Andhra Pradesh, and I have been personally involved in that for more than 5 years now, as has Ravi, C4 ICRAF has been a big pillar of support to that program there. And from the time we got involved, from 40,000 farmers, it has now risen to 1 million farmers. And by a mile, the world's largest regenerative agriculture program by numbers. Of course, they're smallholders. So some have 1 hectare, 1.5 hectares. So we're not talking hundreds of millions of hectares, but we're certainly talking millions of hectares. But scale that to a national level, India has 120 million smallholder farmers, 170 million hectares of cropland, the largest in the world. And this is a solution that if it pans out across the country, it has catalytic impact for the world, because a ton of CO2 mitigated in India or in the United States or in Australia is all the same for the planet. So currently it's about 750 million tons. That's the agricultural emissions in India. So if it can even be halved, you are talking significant reduction in emissions. That's just the reduction part. Then there is the sequestration, which could be an equally large number and even bigger. As we know, soils hold about 1.5 trillion tons of CO2 equivalent. And if you go 2 meters deep, it's 2.4 trillion tons. that's the size of carbon that's in the soil. So if we can really bring it back, we have a solution made for people, made for the planet, and of course made for all the other 8 million species that we keep talking about. So that's what we are talking today. That's how big this is. That's how important it is. And we've already heard from international perspective, national perspective, research perspective in different continents, and the fact that it works. So I think it's a good time for the audience to ask a few incisive questions to our esteemed panelists. So please raise your hand, identify yourself, and ask on. We can get somebody to move the microphone around, or I can get up and go around. You'll help. Thank you. Okay. So you're asking the question? Ah, sure, please go ahead, and then pass it on to anybody else check, that check. Wishes to.
So I heard that we want to focus on solutions, and I heard some solutions. So and maybe your opinions, what are some of the biggest challenges to scaling those solutions?
Anyone else? Kelly.
Yes. Thank you for your insightful comments. When we talk about regenerative agriculture, I think everybody interprets a different thing. And I want to know from your different perspectives, as you know, maybe a political perspective, a research perspective, a policy or a finance perspective, how important do you think it is to really pin down a more specific definition of what we consider regenerative agriculture to be and what we don't?
In terms of solutions on the farming side, have you, like, how is it adapting to the market side? So are there markets for these products?
Sure. Okay. You have a question?
Hi, I'm Meghna. I know a lot of corporations, I mean, there's a lot of talk about bringing private sector to the conversation when, you know, talking about climate change. How do you bring private sector, like companies like PepsiCo, whose, you know, asset is food, to buy-in into regenerative agriculture as a source of their produce for the products that they put it out for people to consume?
Sure. Okay. So let's start with that. So the questions are, what are the challenges? And what is a not a more acceptable, but a more easily understandable definition of regenerative agriculture so that every stakeholder understands it in the same sense. And then of course, finance, and how do you bring the corporate world into the finding the markets? So these are the three. So
I'll try and keep it as short as possible. On the challenges and the scaling challenges, The big difference between regen agriculture, agroecology, agroforestry is it's knowledge intensive. And the challenge of getting the knowledge out to people who need it has been huge. I'm going to plug what I'm going to say at the We Mean Business Pavilion in a, where we're talking about digital agriculture and the digital platforms that allow us to get out to millions of farmers very, very effectively. So I think we have the means now to scale up knowledge in the way we couldn't before. So that's key, because it is a knowledge intensive system. You put your finger on something, we still have to solve it, but farmers are much, much more connected today to each other through the use of smartphones, through their markets, through their input suppliers. And this is a resource that we need to use much, much better. I'll leave some questions to others. My sense on the definition is it's not as important as we think, right? I think the most important thing about regen agriculture is the concept that you leave your agro environment better off than when you found it. If you can do that, you know, the minister spoke about agroforestry and he said, we're talking about persuading our indigenous communities to go back to agroforestry. And then he said, but regen agriculture is new to us. Agroforestry is regen agriculture. It's the great grandparent of anything to do with regen agriculture, because it leaves it better than it finds it. And communities know this. There is a challenge, though, and I think, Eric, you pointed to it. People need to be better off. It's not just the environment. It doesn't work if people aren't better off. And you spoke about that. We're going to speak at the Global Landscapes Forum on something called the stewardship economy. It's a different way of thinking about the economy, a new paradigm. So if you haven't heard about the Global Landscape Forum, it's taking place at the Savoy Hotel on Friday and Saturday. Do come, because that's what we're talking about over there.
Thank you. So about the challenges. Yeah, there's a lot of challenges. Like if I'm talking about SRI as a method, a knowledge intense method. So there's pros and cons to knowledge intense methods. No, because once the farmer has the knowledge, he's independent. So which I think is actually the most powerful attribute to that type of, you know, the ecological intensive agriculture, because farmers are independent in making decisions. But the challenges that I've been facing, we have been facing in the global community on changing rice production, the farmers see the benefit. The farmers want it. The farmers ask us to come train them. And the donors don't, you know, they're somewhere else making decisions. They're sitting somewhere in, I don't know, in a headquarters and writing, saying, so there's this mismatch. There's the demand from the field that doesn't match what people design as projects. Then the other part, so farmers are not at the table. So then the other really big challenge is agriculture. To change agriculture takes time. So imagine a farmer plants first time a rice differently. Okay, this is interesting. Second year, oh, now I see it's repeated. The third year has to go the third year. Oh, right. This could be something for me. But if he's the only farmer in his irrigation scheme who reduces the water, and the others will say, no, our water comes through and you'll have your fields flooded. So then you have a community aspect, no? So that you need to start to work with the community. That may take 1, 2, 3 years. And then comes the challenges of equipment. Oh, I don't have a seeding machine or this machine or that machine that plants or a no-till machine, you know, anything. So at least 10 years, if you talk about adoption of changing in a crop like rice, takes a lot of time. And right now, when we get a grant, it's 3 years maximum, 4 years. Farmers just get started, they will be dropped. Farmers can continue, they get dropped. Technical expertise get built up, it gets dropped, gets moved around. And so it's an incredible journey. And if you don't just commit to it, you know, it's just always like, you never move forward, you know. And so right now we have 4% of the global world area that's planted under SRI. SRI could be a solution to food security, to methane emission reduction, and rice needs to be a solution because rice is the second largest methane emitter in agriculture with 12% of man-made methane emissions. We need to use that type of methods to, you know, to address those solutions. And so we need long-term commitments. And I don't know where that comes from the policies, from the finance, from, you know, to support actually the farmers who want to move forward.
Thank you. And I would start from where you left off in terms of changes. I would say one of the biggest challenge is the resistance and adaptation to changes. Generally, whether from a policy level or from a government level, whether we decide that we're going to move to legislation, whether we're going to move towards policies or programs, or whether we're going to provide incentives or create incentives for regenerative farming. I think that might be a conversation that many countries would have to start. If we're going to adopt to this new method of farming, which is climate friendly, then governments would have to act decisively whether by, as I mentioned, by legislation or more attractive by incentives, by way of incentives. But I can speak for the Caribbean specifically, CARICOM specifically. Some of our greatest challenge, obviously, is the access to financing. Access to financing and the cost of financing, too, has been one of the biggest challenge for us. Because if you're going to save the farmers, you need specialized equipment, you need to buy different types of machinery, then it comes back to financing. And as I mentioned earlier, we are not mega farms. We don't have mega farmers in the Caribbean. We are now growing our agriculture sector. So financing and access to it would be one of the biggest challenge I would identify, other than change and adaptation. Technology, the use of technology, knowledge, skills transfer. This is still new to us, and it will require a large amount of knowledge transfer, of training. The market, as you mentioned, is also another challenge for us. But we know that we're heading to a place where the demand for food will increase. The world's population will grow by maybe another 2 billion in another 30 years from now. So the demand not only for energy, but also for food will increase significantly. So agriculture should be seen as maybe one of the most lucrative business to go into. And access to capital on the private sector side, we have been trying to engage our private sector in a more active way, and not to have governments cultivating or being involved in agriculture. But again, access to financing in the Caribbean is one of the biggest challenge. Another issue that, well, we don't experience it in Guyana, but in our sister CARICOM countries, it will require some amount of deforestation if we're going to scale up cultivation. For example, in Grenada, where they cultivate spices, Grenada is very small. So it means cutting down their small forests to go into agriculture. In Guyana, luckily, we don't have that issue. So I would say those are some of the major challenges that we have faced in our part of the in the world. And we are working closely with the private sector because we see them as our biggest partner today. As I mentioned earlier, we venture into soya beans and corn, wheat, coffee, cocoa for the very first time. I know cocoa and coffee was cultivated centuries ago. So we are bringing it back now in partnership and in collaboration with our private sector, with support, of course, from the government and incentives being given by our government. Thank you.
Seems we are a lot in agreement. Very briefly, yes, carbon credits have a huge role to play in financing many of these efforts, and carbon credits is a much more secure source of financing than development aid, which tend to be the focus of this conference. Development aid will never produce any massive money. Carbon credits, done right, can do. On the issue of definition, I completely agree. I mean, definition is not important in my view. What's important is knowledge and learning, because there will also be, of course, evolving learning. But learn from the best, highlight the best, make sure that the best examples from the world are highlighted to everyone, and learn from the individual farmers who do well. I remember I spoke to the Minister of Agriculture of Vietnam, who was the man behind the Vietnamese agriculture miracle, and he said the most important of all was to make sure that one farmer was very successful in every village. Because if you are successful, well, I want to go to you to learn. And it's as simple as that. So there is no central committee of the world led by Joseph Stalin who can send out directives about definition. So let's learn from the best. Then, of course, it's all about win-wins. That's, in my view, the biggest mistake of us environmentalists up through history. We frame the discussion as win-lose. We said, and if you want to be nature positive, or if you want to protect nature, oh, there will be a lot of suffering. We have to live a much more simple and worse life. Well, that works with no one except a few intellectuals. It works with intellectuals in most nations, but no one can go to a farmer in India or in Mali to tell that person, oh, climate change is so important to the world So you need to produce less for your family and you need to suffer for the world. But it doesn't work with anyone else either. It doesn't work with anyone in the United States or Europe either. And now we have, for the first time in human history, the win-win stories to tell in every area. Going green produce more, not less jobs. Produce prosperity, not poverty. And let's go for all these win-win solutions. Also, core of this, of course, is the fact that solar energy is now the cheapest energy everywhere in the world. And finally, your question about business. I believe that the best tool is naming and shaming. Naming in the world, or faming and shaming. Fame those businesses who do well. NGOs tend to be very weak at that, that they should be much less reluctant to tell, but that company is doing well. Think of maybe my favorite global example, Danish company Ørsted. They were a 100% oil company. Then the leaders of the company decided we want to change. And after a few years, they are now the biggest or one of the biggest windmill producers in the world, completely out of oil, completely into wind. And it's the same company that changed the name. But, and they took the staff and the shareholders and the customers on this journey, and they succeeded. So this, but there are of course many, many, many examples of the same. I mentioned this Indonesian company called RGE, but I can mention many more. Let's name and fame these companies, and let's name and shame the companies who do work to destroy the world.
Well, thank you. Thank you. I want to close by thanking Ika for putting up this wonderful pavilion that we could use this morning. And thank you to our excellent panelists for their insights and bringing back focus on regenerative agriculture. Let me close by saying that finance is not a problem. The Andhra Pradesh case is telling, because there, and from my own experience, in 2016, we were setting up something called the Tropical Landscapes Finance Facility in Indonesia. When Eric was the head of UNEP, UNEP was supporting that idea. I was, of course, outside the UN system at that time, working pro bono to bring this idea to life. And I met KfW, the German Development Bank at that time, among many financial institutions I met, to catalyze the first investment in a $400 million project to save a 400,000 hectare rainforest. We succeeded, but without KfW or any development bank for that matter. And KfW actually at that time famously told me, oh, we don't do agriculture. It is too risky. And of course the example the MD gave me at that time said, I just raised 1.8 billion euros. You know, how much is the cost of capital? I said, well, maybe less. He said, no, it's 0.18%. That's how little they pay to raise money, because they manage their risk so effectively, and agriculture does not fit into that. That was 2016. When 2017, we started the engagement in India. So then I went back to KfW, not their global one, but the India head, and a lot of other people. So I was talking to all the development banks present in India. KfW sounded interested. Within a year, they had changed their mind. Not quite. Come 2020, they signed an MOU to provide 300 million euros at 0.5% interest to Andhra Pradesh. They further supplemented with another 20 million euros for setting up the Indo-German Center of Excellence in Agroecology. And now we are working on a $1 billion idea to prevent wastage of food. 40% food is wasted worldwide. The only difference between the developed world and the developing world is that in the developing world, it's between the agricultural field and the grocery store. In the developed world, it's between the grocery store and the dining table. But it's lost in both the places. We're working on a $1 billion idea to set up a string of 13,000 warehouses, both dry and wet, a cold storage and a humidity controlled warehouse in 13,000 locations in Andhra Pradesh. that will prevent food loss and potentially increase the farmer's income by 200%. To give you an example of tomatoes in India, at harvest, it sells for roughly about $10 US dollar cents, if you find a market. Many a times, farmers actually take truckloads of them and throw them in the highways to make a point because they can't find anybody to buy. Hold it for 3 months, the price increases by 200%. It sells for 30 cents, 24, 25 rupees. So if somebody can hold it for the farmer, and then you have accumulated, aggregated hundreds of thousands of tons of agricultural produces in a safe, clean, and a secure environment without any contamination, you have suddenly created the world's largest clean food market. So that's where the possibilities are. And the minister is absolutely right. We need to find where the land is. We need to stop this business of nutrient mining, which is currently going on rampantly across the planet. We cut down forests, we turn it into agricultural land, we destroy it, then we move on to new frontiers. The bad news is that we've run out of forests. So that's where regenerative agriculture plays a huge role in bringing back our ecosystems, keeping us fed, ensuring food security. And the Caribbean, as a region, has no reason to be importing 95% of what it consumes. It has land. It has arable land. It is rainfall positive. I mean, there's simply no reason. But it's the tourism sector. Sometimes, you know, you get too comfortable with what you have. You don't need to do other things. But as COVID has told us, that you really need to have that resilience in multiple sectors. And I'm glad that CARICOM has taken this wonderful initiative. Last year in Glasgow, we launched a program with the Honorable Prime Minister of Jamaica, and agroforestry was moving that in a big way. And we'll be working with you as well in Guyana. Looking forward to it. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, and thanks for coming. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very good.
Thank you, Ravi.
Thank you.